Good morning, church. How's everybody doing this morning? So nice to see each of you. Whether you need renewal, whether you need joy in your hearts, we are so glad that you're here, and we hope that you receive it here through the awesome works of God. Amen. This is going to be a great day. Oh, my gosh. I already hear a lot of y'all are about to audition for the percussion section in the band today. This is great. Let's get some energy in this place. Stand if you're able. We're going to begin in song. Use those hand clappers super loud. We want to hear it. Come on. Come on, sing with me. I raise
a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies, and I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief, and I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody, and I raise a hallelujah, and heaven calls to fight for me. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise, death is defeated, and the King is alive. And I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. Oh, I will watch the darkness flee. Oh, we'll raise a hallelujah. Oh, in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Hold on me. I'm gonna sing, and I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, and louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, and the King is alive.
Worship band in the peninsula, right? We welcome Natalie Heller back. Woo! Have you graduated yet? Not this year. Next year. Okay, good. All right. Well, I don't know why I chose these two colors to wave around this morning. I don't know why. But today is Senior Sunday, or it's Graduation Sunday, or it's Move Up Sunday. And so if you're a teacher, if you are an administrator, if you're a student, if you're a parent, this is your day to celebrate. And we're going to do that in a moment. So congratulations. We have some real live missionaries in the room today. So you've heard of missionaries before, like David Livingston. These are real life missionaries that just got back from Guatemala at midnight last night, where they were doing medical mission work in a very tough part of the world to do so. So Paul and Karen Preston are here, our two medical missionaries. Very cool. All right, good news today is that we have water. We have water. Praise God, right? Bad news is we don't know if our Wi-Fi is working, so reason you can't. No, I'm just kidding. The Wi-Fi is not working that well, so if I cut in and out early, feel free to go check out your favorite preacher that is not me. But we also have lots of messages online. Lastly, it's graduation Sunday. We recognize those who graduated from this life into the next. Two people who graduated from this life into the next. One, a lovely woman named Jeanette Erdman, had her memorial service here yesterday. And another lovely woman named June Trish had her memorial service here yesterday. Blessed are those who die in the Lord, says the Spirit. They will rest from their labors, but their deeds will always be remembered. We honor them. All right, let's invite up the kicking killer, awesome dope of a pastor, Cynthia Purvis. Come on up here.
I don't think I've ever had an introduction like that. Okay, so some of you are holding noisemakers, hopefully. Let's practice. Let's do a little rehearsal. Let's make some noise. Oh, you guys can do so much better. Get loud. Awesome. Okay, great. So today is a little different. I'm going to welcome to the stage anyone under the age of 18, 19, I don't know. Anyone under a senior in high school. So that includes high school, middle school, elementary, young kids. Everyone come forward. Bring your noisemakers. Bring your confetti. Because we're going to do an activity, and we're going to make a mess, which is my favorite. So come on up here. Join me. We're going to stand. So if you just finished preschool, how many of you just finished preschool? All right. Come stand right here. Yes. Okay. Awesome. I'm so excited. Okay. Anyone else moving on from preschool to kindergarten? Eleanor, are you going to go to kindergarten next year? Yes, perfect. Come join me. All right, yes. Let's give it up for our kindergartners. Okay, and are you guys ready to make a mess? So you can go ahead and put your noisemakers on the ground, Eleanor, because we are going to blow some confetti. Okay, so I see that you've got some confetti wands. Great. So the beautiful thing about this is you just pop off the top. Here you go. All right, pop off the top here. I know, these are ones you really gotta work for. Okay, ready? All right, let's hear it for our new kindergartners. Go ahead and wave those confetti wands. Woo-hoo! Yes! All right, good job, Eleanor. Okay, where are my new kindergartners through fifth graders? Okay, so I'm going to have my preschool new kindergartners come to the left. So come over here. All right. Where are my new elementary kids? Anybody moving up a grade? Madeline, you're moving up a grade. Come on over here. All right. So, Amelia. Okay, so anyone going into a new grade, Cora, in elementary school? Awesome. Come join. Come join. Come on up. All right. Josie, you're going into a new grade in elementary school? You're going to first grade. Right, okay, so there's a couple steps, but that's okay. All right, you guys get to make a mess too. You guys all have your confetti wands? Okay, I'm gonna get you one, okay? All right, pull off the tops, and then we're going to make some noise. Yeah, I know. They're safer, but they are a little bit more intense. Okay, got your... I got you. Here you go. All right. Okay. There you go. Okay, elementary kids, are you all ready? Ready to make a mess?
Yeah.
All right. Let's hear it for our elementary kids. Go ahead, make some noise. All right. Where are my fifth graders going into sixth grade? All right, and then if you guys all want to shuffle down to the left, shuffle to the left, into fifth grade or sixth grade. Yes, welcome to the stage. Welcome to middle school. All right, come on up, Sean. Okay, you're sixth going into seventh. All right, our new middle schoolers, get ready. You can, I'll hold these for you. All right, let's hear it for our middle schoolers. Go ahead and make some noise. Woo! I'll help you. I know. There you go. Just wave it around. Woo! Nice! All right. Are there any eighth graders here? So you can have these back. All right. Are there any ninth graders, 10th graders? Okay. Iris, did you seriously think you could get out of this? Like, I love that you thought that. All right, come on up. So I'm going to welcome Iris and Dylan and Christine. I know, this is your nightmare. It's great, it's great. You get to just make a mess. Go crazy, go ahead. They're gonna confer. You twist it to the left. Yeah, do it now. It's okay, no one's watching. Woo! All right, and then Dylan, if you want to join me, and Christine, if you want to join me. Okay, so we are graduating some seniors, and today we have a special prayer for them, so come forward. So we have Christine Miller and Dylan Daly. We have a couple of seniors who couldn't be here today, so go ahead and come stand in the middle. So Dylan, this is your lovely senior picture. Great job, looking good. We also have Nathan Gum. Nathan couldn't be with us today. Nathan's sister's birthday is also today, so happy birthday, Megan. We also have Robert Peterson. He is playing baseball, and so he couldn't be here today. He's gonna go to the University of Michigan, and he will also be playing baseball there. And then Dylan and Christine. So Christine, oh, come forward. Christine, you wanna come join us? We're gonna pray for you. Often we think of graduation as goodbye, but this is actually hello, because we are welcoming you into the community as an adult. And so you have always been part of this community. You will continue to be part of this community. And now you are welcomed in as an adult. Is there any parent who has an older child who has already gone through this graduation process? Go ahead and raise your hand. Awesome. Cool. Can I ask you to come forward? Since you have been a part of this process, you've gone through it. So yeah, come forward. Come to this stage. And I'm going to ask Dylan's family to come join us, as well as Kurt to come join us. And we're going to circle up. So everyone on this stage, what we're going to do is we are going to pray for Dylan and Christine. So go ahead and reach a hand out to someone, put your hand on someone's shoulder. And there are parents who have gone through this before, and so they are going to be part of this prayer circle because they know what it's like to graduate a student. They know what it's like to go through that. So we are one community, so let's join in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the gift of joy and celebration. We lift up our seniors. We're so grateful for who they are and who you are transforming them to become. Lord, we pray that you pave the path in front of them with joy and gladness. Give them life lessons and wisdom to seek and understand more of your truth and your presence. Remind them that they are never alone, that you are with them and we are with them as well. Be with their parents, their family members, their guardians, their grandparents, who also support from behind. Give them energy and encouragement and compassion and empathy. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, so thank you for joining us up here. We are going to head out the side door. On your way out, leave your noisemakers behind. I know, that sounds like a sad thing, but we're gonna leave our noisemakers in church for Graham during his sermon. So if you are one of our Next Gen kids, you're gonna go with our wonderful staff out that door, so go ahead and head that way. Oh, do you wanna dump that? Here, go ahead. There you go, dump it. And for all of us here in the room, why don't we go ahead and stand up and greet one another. Say hello, let everyone know you're here. Thank you. Lift it up to the ceiling, cause we all need that healing. Let's get lost in the feeling, the feeling, the feeling. Lift it up to the ceiling, cause we all need that healing. Let's get lost in the feeling.
All right, church, it's so great to see each of y'all share in love with one another. Go ahead, find your way back to your pew. Stay standing. We're going to continue to worship. What an awesome ceremony that was.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome? A slave to
singing with us. Amen. Let's continue now. Let's pray. I invite you to bow your heads and assume a posture of prayer. Creator God, we know through the word that you've created us and that we're your children, that we're never alone. God, we know this, but singing songs like this is so helpful to be reminded. And this is why we worship, God. This is why we gather. Because sometimes in our week, in our lives, it's easy to forget. But we give you thanks for the opportunity for this church, the people here that we get to worship with, the people that we get to love on, the people that we get to go through life with. God, some of us are hurting right now. Some of us hear the word joy and just think, I don't got it today, God. Put healing hands on us, Lord. God, I ask that you would make us wiser people. Inspire us to be more creative. Inspire us to be more compassionate. God, inspire us to be more loving than we can ever imagine in the ways that your son taught us. We lay all this at your feet in joy, in all of it. Thank you for loving us and for never leaving our side. In your holy name we pray these things. Amen. You could be seated at church. Amen.
When I had jelly beans and I let them flow all over the floor, this is even better than jelly beans. And we are a celebrative church. We are a worshipful church. This is not our only worship space. Our other worship space is our chapel. There have been two meetings about the renovations in the chapel, and there's another one, and you don't even have to come to church. You can stay home at 7 o'clock in your virtual community email that went out Friday. There is a link to that Zoom presentation. You can also find it in your Burl Prez June email that went out. So just go find your trash, go find your spam, and pull it back up and sign on if you have not already seen the presentation. It's amazing. You're going to be so pleased with the way in which this group of people have dedicated themselves to thinking about our chapel for the future. The second thing I want to remind you of is that next week, and I tried to get as close to it as I could this morning, it's Hawaiian Shirt Sunday. So women, you can wear your muumuus. Men, you wear your Hawaiian shirts. And in honor of the past, we have moved the Mexico auction to Father's Day, moved it back to Father's Day. So there is going to be a silent auction in the lobby. There is also going to be an email that will go out to you that will describe some of those amazing items, some of which are designed just for dads, 49er tickets, next year's Warrior tickets, and some of which you're just going to want to bid on because Jane's going to have you over to her house, six of you, for dinner. And I'm working on one other one. So check out the email and figure out how to bid and bid high. There's going to be a live auction. You need to know this because you need to get here early at 10:15 for any of the items that are listed for that. And Karen and Paul Preston are in the back of our church. Astrid and Tom also went on our Guatemala trip this past week. We are a church that believes in mission, and so That's why we have these events. But it's not just those missions. There is mission that this church does each and every day of the week. And so come now with your tithes and your offering to support the missions of this church.
It all comes down to this: what do you require of me? Love my neighbor as myself, and you above all things. Act justly, love mercy, walk humbly with you, God. Down to this, to be your hands and feet, good news to all the world, whose truth will set us free. Act justly, love mercy, walk humbly with you, God, in all things, in all ways. It's closer and closer, the kingdom of heaven. It's beauty for ashes, it's morning, the dancing. It's closer and closer, the kingdom of heaven. Well, years from now, we'll see the fruit our hands. Faith just like a seed, the only way it grows. Hey, act justly, love mercy, walk humbly.
Welcome again, welcome again. As you can see, it's a celebration in this church, and we should start by just congratulating our new associate pastor who started in January, and you see what God is doing through her ministry. So let's thank God for what God is doing through Cynthia. We say hi to our friends in Irvine, California. Thanks for being a part of our service, and we pray that you feel the presence of the Spirit wherever you're worshiping. As you've heard, it's a celebration. Now, here's two more celebratory things. We had an installation confirmation of our associate pastor for the Mandarin Thai congregation, Elaine Lang, and that happened in this church. And you may not realize that there are hundreds of folks in the Mandarin Thai community who are connected to God through this church. And so praise God for Elaine. Also, as you go outside the door today, notice that there is a big construction project going on, and that is a picnic area that our church is putting together for our neighbors. And you're going to hear more about this as the years advance. We're going to do more and more for our community around us. And so this is a picnic area for them. And thanks to our BNG department and our Boy Scouts for helping there. Yeah. So even though it's a celebration here at our church most days, it has not been a celebration in the world this last week. Let's just walk through the week. On Monday, an 11-year-old fourth grader testified in Congress about a shooting that took place in her classroom. On Tuesday, we heard about a little tiny town in the Ukraine, Severodonetsk in Donbas, that has literally been razed to the ground. On Wednesday, we heard about another mass shooting in Maryland and an assassination attempt against a sitting United States Supreme Court justice. On Thursday, many of us watched the television and were reminded of the violence and the carnage which happened on January the 6th. We live in a conflicted world. Conflict is our mission statement as a world right now. And I believe that it is our call as Christians to be anti-conflict people at this time, to be peacemakers. That when Jesus calls us to be blessed and to be a peacemaker, he means us. So everybody in this room has some conflict. It may not be in the Donbas or it may not be in Maryland, but you have some conflict. I want you to think about that today as we look at another question of Jesus. Jesus, as we've seen, asks 307 questions in his ministry. And anytime you hear a question from Jesus, I just encourage you to see that as a question for you. But today, we're going to look at a question Jesus asks in a story called the Good Samaritan. Now, you've heard sermons about the Good Samaritan more than you can count. You've heard questions about who is your Samaritan, who is the Levite, who is the Sadducee. But today I want to take lessons from Jesus, who I personally believe was the greatest conflict diffuser in the history of conflict diffusion. Let's see what we can't learn from Jesus on this day in which God is calling us to diffuse the conflicts around us. Thank you, Lord, that the church continues to be a place of celebration. And yet when we leave this room today, we confess to you that each one of us will encounter somewhere in this week some conflict. Maybe it'll be a family member or a work colleague. Maybe it'll be a spouse. Maybe it'll be a neighbor. Maybe it'll be just somebody driving down the street trying to create conflict with us. God, be with us today as we listen to your story about how you diffused a conflict. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So what's the hardest job in the world? What's the hardest job in the world? We might say it could be a fireman or a TSA security guard or a policeman or a missionary. It could be that it's a sewer cleaner or a politician, a United States president. But I believe the toughest job on the face of the earth is being a school principal. Do we have any school principals here today? They're taking a deserved break. Okay. School principaling, I think, is hard on 5 or 10 different fronts. You have conflicts with students. You have conflicts with faculty. You have conflicts with parents. And as one lifelong school principal told me after last service, if she'd have heard my sermon earlier in her career, it would have helped. Because she said, you forgot one, it's the board above you that creates conflict. I talked to a leading school principal in this area this last week. I had lunch with her, and she just told me about all the challenges she faces on a daily basis. People trying to engage her in conflict. I had another friend who is a principal in Montecito, California, and he said that every Monday, a parent would be in his office complaining about something the school had done that created a problem for the kid. So for 30 minutes, my kid is failing math, my kid is failing humanities, my kid never comes to school, and it's your fault as a principal. So after about 30 minutes of this, this friend of mine said he would do the same thing every time. He'd say, are you finished? Have you shared everything on your heart? Here's my question for you. He said, what is it that you would like me to do for you? And after pausing for a moment, most parents would say, you know, actually, I don't think there's anything that you could do for me. Okay, said the principal, if you could think of something, please let me know this next week. Now that ability to diffuse conflict with a question is right out of Jesus's playbook. And I'm gonna call it the Jesus path today. Jesus asks 307 questions, and if you look at the questions, most of them are an ability to diffuse conflict. People will come to him with an argument, with a beef, with something they're trying to bring Jesus down in, and he diffuses the conflict initially through a question. But let's take a look at the conflict at the heart of the Good Samaritan story. Now, the problem with this text is the story itself is so rich that we often forget the conflict around it. So we look at the Samaritan, the terrible story from Jericho to Jerusalem, to Jerusalem to Jericho, and being robbed, and it's just beautiful. But what we forget is Jesus is deflecting a huge conflict here. Let me give you a little background. In 66 BC, Pompey is the emperor of Rome. And from Rome, he cannot oversee and adjudicate every conflict happening in the Holy Land. So he puts together a group called the Sanhedrin, or the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin is supposed to adjudicate conflicts. So one farmer comes in with another problem with another farmer, another market worker comes in with another problem with another market worker, and the Sanhedrin would oversee these conflicts. But in about 1 AD, Herod takes over the adjudication of conflicts in the Holy Land. And as you saw from the crucifixion, how well that went. But he takes away all of the day-to-day conflicts that people are supposed to have adjudicated by the Sanhedrin. And he says to the Sanhedrin, you guys just focus on theology, theological issues, mostly heresy. So the Sanhedrin, who have literally hundreds of policemen out on the streets, they're known as experts in the law, are like KGB agents. They're like Taliban. They're always out trying to glean little bits of information about heresy. But there isn't any heresy in the first century. Everyone, just like you and I, are trying to get through our day. Except for one, a man from Galilee, a redneck from Nazareth named Jesus. And so hundreds of these law experts are sent out every day to investigate Jesus. So here is the background for the conflict we hear today that Jesus diffuses with absolute dexterity, deftness, and beauty. Let's listen for God's word. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Now, test is a bad word here for what this man does. The real word in Greek is exitazo or dokimazo, and that literally means to tempt, to tempt. It's the same word that the evil one is used with Jesus in the desert. He is tempted, which is a good thing to begin with in terms of conflict. Most initiators of conflict for our lives are tempting us into an argument. So this last week has been fun. My daughter Haley and I have had so much good, positive time. My wife Star and the kids are in Tucson at 125 degrees heat down there. And so it's just Haley and I. And I need to just underline how wonderful it's been, just father, daughter. We went grocery shopping. We've had a great time. And yet, there are moments when my daughter has such an ability to draw me into an argument. Now, parents, am I the only one here who has ever experienced this? And maybe it's junior high girls, I'm not sure, but sometimes when I come in and I say, have you done your homework? She says, what right do you have to ask me if I've done my homework? Can I check on you in an hour? This is not your room. This is my room. Now, just to be fair, I don't think it's just junior high girls who do this. I talked to a parent on the way out. She has a 53-year-old daughter. That daughter can get her into an argument 0 to 100 miles an hour in 2 seconds. And because I know there are students here, I've asked students, has that ever happened on your side that you feel tempted into an argument by your parents? So lots of kids here today. Have you ever been tempted into an argument by your parents? Kids tell me it often happens. They feel like their parents always ask them all these questions, like, are you doing your homework? Have you taken a shower? Anyway, let's leave that one there. This law expert is better than a junior high girl in trying to tempt Jesus into an argument. And so this is how he does it. He asks a question. Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, if Jesus answers this wrong, he will go right to death row. Because if he has a pathway to inheritance of eternal life, he must have some pathway to God. But here's how Jesus diffuses the argument. He starts with a question. Ask questions is the first path to diffusing argument. I had a friend who's a therapist tell me that in about the third or the fourth month of therapy, it's quite common to have someone come to him and say, you are not helping me. I'm wasting my time. I'm wasting my money. It's your fault that my life is in trouble. At which point my therapist friend begins with questions. How would you like to spend time better? What else would you like to spend your money on other than this therapy session? And he said that two things happen. One, he puts the ball in their court, but two, it gives him time to actually think of an answer. This is what Jesus does. He asks him a question. He asks him, what is written in the law? And two, how do you read it? In other words, he doesn't just ask him a question. He appeals to his intellect. So you're smart. What do you think? He asks a question. And the man gives a pretty cookie-cutter answer. He answers, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself, which was kind of like the answer to every question in Judaic law back in the day. Then Jesus affirms the man. So the first thing to do in diffusing conflict is ask. The second thing is affirm. So what does Jesus say? You got it. A plus. First in your class. You answered correctly. Do this and you will live. There is always something in somebody else, no matter how much you disagree with them, that you can affirm. We've been seeing this, and I don't know if anyone is going to be watching the basketball game tomorrow night between the Warriors. A few people? Okay, good. One of the things I'm so proud of about the Warriors is that no matter what happens on the court, in the post-game interview, they always affirm the other team. My favorite example of this is Draymond Green, who's not getting a lot of good press now, even from his own mom. But Draymond Green was asked after one of the previous games, tell us about the other team. What was your strategy? And he said, well, I just want to affirm how good that team was. And in fact, on one occasion, he said, and in fact, I walked up to Nikola Jokic, and I said to him, thank you for making me a better player. Steve Kerr is the best at this. He was asked this last week, how would you respond to the really mean things that were shouted at Draymond Green in Boston? By the way, did you notice why there were a bunch of bleeps? It's because they couldn't even air the things on TV that were being said. And Steve Kerr just said, graceful, classy. And he then said, you know, they are a great team. There's always something you can affirm in the other person. This man is trying to kill Jesus, and he affirms, good job. But the man's not done. He has another question. And he asks him, but who is my neighbor? And you can hear the anger through the years the petulance from this law examiner, who's my neighbor? This is where Jesus depersonalizes. So this is our three part. Ask questions, affirm the other person, depersonalize. And it's where Jesus tells a story. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. When he was attacked by robbers, they stripped him of his clothes, they beat him, and they went away, leaving him half dead. It's a story. Now, stories are probably not going to work for you to depersonalize. It's a great Jesus technique. On the way home today, if somebody cuts you off in traffic and gesticulates with a certain digit in their hand, don't roll down the window and say, "There once was a man who cut me off in traffic. He liked to wave at people as they went by." That's not going to work for you. But there are some ways to depersonalize it, even if you just remember that almost no argument is about you. It's taken me years to learn this, and I still haven't. I will be 100 years old before I figure this out. I am wired to react to arguments. Maybe it's a Scottish thing. I don't know. But it has helped me. I went to in a class for my doctorate from one of the leading experts in conflict management, Dr. David Augsburger. Smart man. And he said there's two things about conflict. One, it's never about you, and remember that. So here's an example of that. I was pastoring a little church in Northern California, and about 3 months in, I got some conflict people, some critiques saying that I was spending too much time in my office, and they wanted me to be spending more time doing pastoral care. So fair enough, I said. So I'm just going to go 2 or 3 weeks, I'm just going to do pastoral care, pastoral care, pastoral care. The next thing I heard is that I was spending too much time doing pastoral care and not enough time in the office. So then I decided to just tell them where I was at every moment of the day. So I had all these signs. I had 25 signs printed out. Pastor is in the hospital. Pastor is in the nursing home. Pastor is in the bathroom. Pastor is flossing his teeth. This did not help. What I learned is that the real issue was not me, but that they had felt abandoned by the previous pastor. And so when I wasn't around or they didn't know where I was, they thought I was abandoning them. It's never about you. The second thing is, if somebody comes to you with an argument, you are not the first person who has ever been come to by them with an argument. If you could just look at the tape of their life, you would see that this is replayed again and again and again. And the reason is because most people who come to us in conflict are really about blame. Here's a cartoon that I thought really captured this nicely. This is a boardroom, and the director of the board says, "And now at this point in the meeting, I'd like to shift the blame away from me and onto someone else." Here's another one that I thought was kind of cute. It was two dogs, one in therapy, the other's the therapist. And the one in therapy says, "I bark at everything. Can't go wrong that way." There are some people who just bark at everything. It's never about you. You're not the only one they have ever gotten into an argument with. Try to depersonalize it. I've wondered this last week, what might have happened if 2 weeks before January 6th, some of the people who were going to the Capitol to do harm had had someone come into their life and say, "You have so much passion. You have so much energy. You have so many good ideas. I wonder what it might be like if you would spend a little bit of time in Guatemala or Honduras or India. And I wonder if you might be able to use that passion constructively there." Ask, affirm, depersonalize. But don't stop asking. So Jesus tells the story, and it would be so easy for Jesus to close the Bible, walk away, done for the day. But then he asks this man another question. "Which one of these three do you think was the neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" He's appealing to his better interest. You probably won't remember all of these pieces, even though it's pretty easy to remember. Ask, affirm, depersonalize, ask. But if you don't remember any of them, just remember the ask questions. You can't ask enough questions in conflict. And so the man answers, the one who had mercy on him. And then Jesus does the last and important thing in diffusing conflict. He honors what he can in the other person. He says of this man who's trying to kill him, go and do likewise. A plus. You got it. You can do it. I believe in you. There's always something you can honor in anybody that comes to you in conflict. There's one more thing that has helped me, and that is to realize that when people come to you in anger, it is all about the pain they are feeling in their personal lives. And I don't know if there's a time in our adult lives when people have felt more pain. People are in pain now. Here's a way to illustrate this in a funny way. There was a New York Times article about a Doberman pincher named Barney who attacked a teddy bear museum in England. Bear with me. This is how the New York Times article went. A guard dog ransacked a teddy bear museum in Western England. Barney, a Doberman pincher, went berserk, shredding about 100 bears on display. Worst of all, Barney destroyed Mabel, which was Elvis Presley's teddy bear. Mabel belonged to an English aristocrat named Benjamin Slade, who lived close to the museum. He had reportedly paid $75,000 for the bear at the Memphis auction, and then loaned it to the museum. The museum general manager, Daniel Medley, said, I had a very embarrassing phone call with the owner of Elvis Presley's teddy bear, and he's not happy at all. Now, Barney the Doberman Pinscher's handler has two theories about why this Doberman went crazy on 100 teddy bears. The first is that there was a rogue scent, but the better theory he has is that maybe Barney was feeling jealous because the handler had Elvis Presley's bear in his arm all morning. You're such a sweet little teddy bear. I love you. Hold me tender, hold me. No, I'm just kidding. Barney was jealous and went crazy on 100 teddy bears. I don't know why people are going so ballistic these days about so much anger. But at the root of it is pain, maybe jealousy, a sense of abandonment. And we will, as Christians, have people come to us in those moments. And it's our call to try as hard as we can to be like Jesus. I'm going to read a bit of a poem as we close from my favorite professor who taught about conflict management, and I don't have time to read the whole poem, but I just want to read you the last stanza as we close. He said, whenever you're in conflict, think of this. I am I, and you are you. If in being our true selves, we find each other in equal regard, it's beautiful. If not, it's sad. Such finding can only come as you love me for being me, and I love you for being you. I will do all I can to find you. I willingly accept whatever responsibility is mine for loving, seeking, finding, and when simultaneously we can fully affirm the other as he is or she is. We meet, and we are we. God, thank you for loving us so much that you've given us not just the call to be peacemakers, but you have modeled it for us. Be with us, Lord, as we head back into this world of conflict. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Friends, stand if you're able for our closing song this morning.
days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Goodness in your life out into the world. See you next week. Love you.